I highly encourage any of you brothers and sisters listening to come and join this train, because it's something amazing is going on.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In Nuzhat al Fikar is one of the books written on the Usul Hadith, on the principles of basically Hadith, that how you study the Hadith and how to verify the Hadith. And there are many verses before that. Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani, one of the late Muhaddith, expert of the Hadith, he wrote his book and summarized all the contents of the book from many, many books written before him. Very big in just summary. And then he wrote commentary on that, and very good commentary. Since he wrote, because he wrote such a nice way and he organized it so nicely, since then the book became part of their curriculum in every single madrasah and every center of learning, wherever people want to learn Hadith and study the Hadith. One of the major texts that they read is the book of Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani, Nukhbat al Fikar, and its commentary. So if people have got any elementary knowledge of the Mustalaha Ahl-Athar, you know, the principle of the Hadith, then if they read this book, they can, you know, their knowledge can move forward, and they can understand, have better understanding how the people in the past they used to authenticate Hadith and what really means to Hadith to be sound, sahih, or da'if, or weak, or fabricated, and what effort people have done, and what are different categories of the Hadith, and also what are the different categories of the books of the Hadith, you know, like Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, and what are the difference between those collections and other different collections in the Muslim history. So this book can give you, kind of summarize a way of understanding of all the effort that have been made by the Muslim in the past. So inshallah, when this course will happen, I'll make my effort to make a good commentary as much as possible on the book, and at the same time to provide a critical explanation of many, many things which are very often, you know, popular among the people, but not necessarily it was the same way understood by the people of our generation, especially Bukhari and Muslim and people like them. You know, I'm trying to say, Ibn Hajar Al-Asqalani, when he wrote his book, is what I feel like introduction. The purpose of the book is not that you understand and you know what Sahih and Daif means fully. So he will have one definition. But in the history of Islam, when people say al-Hadith as Sahih, Sahih Hadith, it is not one simple meaning. When Bukhari says Sahih, he has his whole meaning. When Muslim says Sahih, he has his own meaning. But when Imam Tirmidhi says the Hadith is Sahih, it is not the same meaning. The conditions change. And then after that comes people like Ibn Hibban and Hakim. When they're Sahih, their conditions even become weaker. It is much more loose. Similarly, when people say Hadith is accepted, they don't have the same meaning. When Imam Malik says Hadith is accepted, he has certain conditions in his mind. When Abu Hanifa says Hadith is accepted, certain condition. If you apply condition of Bukhari Muslim to those Hadiths which have been accepted by Abu Hanifa and Malik, they are weak. If you apply the condition of Bukhari Muslim to the Hadith of Abu Hanifa and Malik, many of them will be weak. So we have to understand really what were the conditions, you know, in the mind of Abu Hanifa and Malik, and how they categorize certain things to be acceptable. But when the later generation comes, they change. Why the change happened? Why this evolution happened in the history of Hadith? So many of these things, you know, when it comes, and also many, I have been teaching for a long time, not only in Usul Hadith, also in Usul Fiqh. Many things has come into the Usul Fiqh Hadith. Either the influence of Greek logic and philosophy and Alim al-Kalam, they are not purely part of these sciences. So one has to understand, distinguish these things. What are pure Hadith science and what has come from outside? And now at our time, it all has become mixed. And people actually believe that they are all pure Islam. They are not pure Islam. Some things have been coming from outside. So that we have to make very clear. Inshallah, when I teach, if I have time, I'll point out many of those things which have come from other direction. They are not necessarily from the Hadith. Yeah, you know, the thing basically is, you know, once I taught this book, once I taught in the Oriental Institute in Oxford, in the university, and they said to me that in the history of the Oriental Institute, Usul Hadith never had been taught by a Muslim. The first time it is being taught by a Muslim. And the people are sitting there, they're not Muslim. So when I started my teaching, I said one thing very clearly, that we Muslims believe that Hadith is divine. Hadith is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's divine. If nobody can change, we believe in this properly. Hadith is divine. But when we say Hadith is sound, not sound, when we authenticate the Hadith, this is a human effort. You people, we only want from you one thing. First, make effort to understand how we authenticate. the human effort. Maybe we are right, maybe we are wrong. But first you understand what we have been doing, how we authenticate hadith. Once you understand, then after that, if you can bring something better than that, we have no harm to accept from you. Because this is human effort. In this matter, people who are not believers, they also can make something better than that. So hadith is divine, but you know, the way we authenticate the hadith, that is not divine. In that matter, we can accept anybody's suggestion as long as they understand what we do. So that I explained to them. Maybe some of those things I explained.